Alright, so funny stuff, and then we'll get into the lesson. I found out yesterday on Facebook that February 4th is Friends Day, so make sure you go post to your best friend on Facebook. And that got me to thinking, I know there's a song. My best friend. You guys want to answer back? No? Jesus is my best friend. Jesus is my best friend. I am not alone. Anywho, so, you don't know that one? All right, that's fine. So, there are some among you that might post a best friend they had from elementary school. I know those two ladies, women now, my goodness, back in our nursery, Cassie and Stephanie, have been friends since, I don't know, Arlie and Avery's age. Long, long time. And I'm sure some of you have friends as well that you can say that for a long, long time. All right, let's get into our lesson. Ephesians 6:19. And for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Sean, these past couple of weeks, has been going back to the basics. And I'm going to try to keep with that and not get too deep. It's not too hard for me to do. some of you may be thinking that, but anywho. This song stood out for me, and I'm going to go ahead and read it. I don't know the song itself. 715, 715, if you'd like to read along. It says, the church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the world, or the word. From heaven he came down and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for her life he died. Elect from every nation, yet one or all the earth, her charter of salvation, one Lord, one faith, one birth, one holy name she blesses, partakes one holy food, and to one hope she presses with every grace endued. Mid toil and tribulation and tumult of her war, she waits the consummation of peace forevermore. Till with the vision glorious, her longing eyes are blessed, and the great church victorious shall be the church at rest. This past week, President Trump gave his State of the Union address. That was Tuesday. And there are two things he said that reminded me of what it is for us to be Christians in America. First of all, this is not to be a bash the president sermon or even a praise the president sermon. You'll see that in a moment. This lesson, as all lessons should be, are to give glory to God by reminding us of God's will and Christ's commands so that we one day will live with him in glory. We should try and focus on, as I saw this was pointed out by the writer and physically pointed out by our President of the United States and Mr. Ryan, the Speaker. First, the way he used the word righteous. Well, that kind of made my ears perk up because we know the true meaning of that word. And second was the attention that was given to the words above their heads. In God, we trust. The Speaker of his House raised his hands, and I thought he was actually pointing to heaven, and then realized he was pointing to just mere words. Let's not dwell on just the words. Yes, we dwell on the words in the Bible, but let's not just dwell on the words, let's actually dwell on the Heavenly Father above. Amen? My question to you this morning is, do we give enough thought in our everyday lives? Do we truly place our trust in God above? Are we doing this every hour? Are we doing this right now, this hour? What seems like a pretty easy time, laying aside all other thoughts. I mean, we're in a church building, right? Are we focused on God, on our Lord Jesus Christ? Are we thinking about God above, or are we thinking about our busy schedule for this next week? The title of the lesson is The Lord Reigns, spelled R-E-I-G-N-S. But the question I got asked, or sometimes God sends sprinkles, sometimes it pours. One of the kids in my class was trying to be silly. And he said, God reigns. And of course, if you look into scripture, you'll actually find R-A-I-N-S. Because God does reign. In the beginning, Genesis 1:1, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light, it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. Amos 5:4. For thus says the Lord to the house of Israel, seek me and live. But do not seek Bethel, nor enter Gilgal, nor pass over to Beersheba. For Gilgal shall surely go into captivity, and Bethel shall come to nothing. Seek the Lord and live, lest he break out like fire in the house of Joseph and devour it, with no one to quench it in Bethel. You who turn justice to wormwood and lay righteousness to rest in the earth. He made the Pleiades and Orion. He turned the shadows of death into morning and makes the day dark as night. He calls for the waters of the sea and pours them out on the face of the earth. The Lord, in his name, he rains ruin upon the strong, so that fury comes upon the fortress. It is not about our city, our state, or even the country we live in. It's easy us to stand for a country that tries, keyword there, to honor God in trusting him. Of course, when we're prospering, right? I'm reminded of the song that we sing, humble thyself, and not just for men to see. The words of the song say, humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. Turn to James 4, if you would. James 4, verse 7. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. And now I'll read verse 6. Also from chapter 4 of James. But he gives more grace, therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. We learn this in the book of Proverbs. If you turn over to chapter 3, we could read the whole chapter, but let us just focus on verses 7 and 8, and then we'll skip down to 34 and 35. Right now, we can begin at verse 7. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Sounds like a pretty solid product to me. A good, wholesome, healthy, clean, and chemical-free diet, if you would. Again, for our flesh and bones. He takes care of both, doesn't he? Jumping down to verse 34, surely he scorns the scornful, but gives grace to the humble. The wise shall inherit glory, but shame shall be the legacy of fools. We hear at the end of one's lifetime about their legacy and what they left behind, and how they may have inspired people, or maybe they motivated people to be better in some way, or were just a good example. This really is important to the world. Paul passes on this warning in the book of Corinthians and to the Corinthians. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, we just read, when Paul speaks about him and Apollos, he says, who then is Paul and who is Apollos? But ministers through whom you believed. As the Lord gave to each one, I planted Apollos water, but God gave the increase. So then neither he who plants is anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field, you are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can anyone lay that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now the first thought that came to my mind is, if nothing else is remembered about this lesson today, please remember this scripture. If you'd like to write it down, you're more than welcome to. Again, we could read the entire chapter of verse 3, or chapter 3 in Corinthians. But this particular verse here, it's not just speaking to us, but it speaks to us individually. Again, not only us collectively. Look at verse 9. It says, For you. I'm reminded of another song we sang in the rally. It was kind of a Jamaican song, and they have a unique accent, I'm sure you all know. And it's for me, for you, for we. For me, for you, for we. Jesus is for me. And then it says Jesus is for you and Jesus is for we. For we are God's fellow workers, you are God's field. You are God's building. This is a big deal. We have a big responsibility, and God's grace is there, but that doesn't mean it will be easy. Even though this comes from the good book, God's Word, God gives us a warning in this. Paul knows that we as human beings mess up. Look at verse 10 where it says, let each one take heed how he builds on it. Even though we have been blessed and instructed to sow the seed and build on what? Back up a few words. Paul says, as a wise builder, I have laid the foundation and another builds on it. But the foundation isn't Paul's. For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Again, let us be reminded that Jesus Christ is our firm foundation. Let's turn over to Matthew 21:42, where Jesus actually quotes the Psalms, and said to them, have you read in the scriptures, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, as it is marvelous in our eyes. In Ephesians 2:20, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. In 2 Timothy 2:19, nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands, having this seal, the Lord knows those who are his, and let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. In 1 Peter 2:6, it says, therefore it is also contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. 1 Thessalonians 2:10 through 12. You are witnesses, and God also, have devoutly and justly and blamelessly we behaved ourselves among you who believe, as you know how we exhort and comforted and charge every one of you as a father does his own children, that you would walk worthy of God who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. I like to be reminded that these scriptures can stand the test of time and are of value for us even today. If it were not so, this lesson would be even shorter than it's going to be. For I do not believe my own opinion or any human opinion is fully God's will. This was laid as an example and forged into our cornerstone, Jesus Christ. We may not have been witnesses like the apostles actually seeing Christ raised from the dead or even ascend to heaven. But we do see the miracles and blessings we receive from him on a daily basis. Regularly. I think whatever and however we leave this earth behind, our motivation is in the way we act. We are God's children, and Christ wants us to stand with him and he with us on Judgment Day. He doesn't want any one of us to be there alone, facing the judgment alone, because he knows what that's going to be the result of. Matthew 10:32 says, "Therefore, whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven." This week, in addition to the lesson, I actually finished my first program. It was a simple text program. You can call it a game. A sort of choose your own adventure. I remember when I was back in the ninth grade, I actually loved choose your own adventure books. They were probably one of the only ones I really wanted to read. And I asked my teacher if I could do a book report because she allowed us to pick a book. And I said, "Can I choose this choose your own adventure book?" And she says I could, as long as I mapped out every ending. Yeah, that means you had to read every page. So I didn't get out of work. When you program a choose your own adventure or even write a choose your own adventure story, you have to know where each point dead ends and where you're going to end victoriously. Again, back to the basics for us as Christians. We know the outcome of our final destination. It's written in the book. It tells us if we're faithful to Christ Jesus, we're going to heaven. If we're not, and we deny him, and the words he put in there, and the commands he wrote. Again, back to the basics. In our choose your own adventure, God has given us the freedom of choice. Psalms 18, 1 through 2. We could be like David and say, "I will love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God, my strength, in whom I will trust. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold." Colossians 1, 9 through 11 says, "For this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, be fruitful in every good work, and increase in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power, for all patience and long-suffering with joy." Now, if you didn't notice in the beginning, I actually read Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 19. It was pretty much out of context. And I did that for a reason. You can't just expect the mystery of the gospel to be known to you if you're not reading the entire scripture. You can't pull it out and be like, "Yep, I like that verse, let's go ahead with that verse and I'm done." It doesn't work that way, we know that. And so Ephesians 6:10 starts out, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand, therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all fiery darts from the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to the end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints, and for me, that utterances may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. When we choose the whole, not parts and pieces of it, the whole, when we choose Jesus Christ, who is set already, God did it, it's in His will, it's His, Genesis 1:1, He created it, it's His. The only foundation worth building on is Jesus Christ. Whether it be our daily tasks, our relationship with our friends on this Friends Day, our family, and a little more personal, with your spouse, with your children, even your career, choosing Jesus, setting your sights on God's will, through the Son of God, we will be victorious. Won't you choose today to follow Him and walk by His side? You have that opportunity to be baptized today. If you need the prayers of the church, you can come forward as we stand and sing the invitation song.